In recent years, England has exported two larger-than-life and non-repeatable items to the United States. One was once the pride of the Cunard fleet, now pensioned off as a tourist attraction. The other is very much afloat, alive and singing at the Hollywood Bowl.
Gentlemen, I'd like to welcome you to the Hollywood Bowl. The gentleman you've all been waiting for, the biggest, most colossal, gigantic, fantastic Elton John.
Elton John plays cricket as he plays the piano, dressed to kill and as if his life depended upon it. For the greatest sin in his book is to be boring. And whatever he does, he is seldom far from the madding crowd. At 26, he walks confidently on 5-inch heels where lesser angels fear to tread, sporting coats, hair and spectacles of many colors. Sometimes as bright and unyielding as the diamonds he wears on his fingers, sometimes plunged deep into self-critical gloom. A child with every toy in the shop and not a key to wind them with. In the space of 4 frenetic years, he has come from total obscurity to 3 Rolls Royces in the garage of a house named Hercules. 4 years, 6 million records, and then they stop counting. 4 years of moving relentlessly across the never-never land of sudden wealth, instant failure, on a train that never stops except to throw people off. As much an enigma to himself as to his friends, now possessing no inhibitions, now totally inhibited. Extravagant and generous, seeking fame one moment, determined to reject it the next. The life and soul of the party destroyer. The brilliant mimic, the reluctant performer. Jealous of his privacy, hating to be private. Inventing out of exceptional qualities an exceptional self. Arrogant, contrite, occasionally practicing an infant's tyrannies amongst other infants, sometimes the victim of his own extraordinary talents. Gifted, lonely, gifted even in his loneliness, able to cull from it another facet of his superlative musical perception. A one-off, a true original, a copper-bottomed, coast-to-coast sellout, the legend he has always wanted to become, doing his own thing, asking few favors, bestowing many, making believe that make-believe is the ultimate rip-off, the genuine article, the superstar who does his own hoovering.
I'd like to become a legend. I mean, I'm hung up with legends. I'd like to be like a Mae West or something like that, but I don't think I will be because they're so very, very special.
If it was suddenly all to stop, I just wouldn't know what to do with myself, you know.
It's a bit of a silly life, really. We often think we're completely crazy, all of us, you know.
I like to sit out in the sun and just take it easy.
He was so gifted, he just couldn't lose, I thought, anyway.
I've seen much more of life, and I think I know much more what life is about than I ever would have known had I stayed in Scotland.
I was just a music fan, and I got into a studio as a T-boy and worked my way downwards.
In any business, I think you've got to relate, and I don't mean this coldly, or ruthlessly, you've got to relate to the bottom line.
I'm like a plate of fish waiting to be eaten.
Just an ordinary, average, everyday kind of boy.
Question. Where were you born?
In the classic boring pinner in Middlesex.
When was that?
1947. In 1947, in fact. Both years I was born, in 1947. From the earliest age, I used to sit down at the piano.
Were you the Shirley Temple of the piano?
Possibly. I had the same sort of hair in those days. I sat down at the piano, apparently, according to my mother, and played the Skater's Waltz one day, which was... While she was vacuuming around the room, she suddenly seized upon me and says, I claim £1 million, and you're going to be famous.
What age were you when you amazed your mother with the Skater's Waltz?
About 4, I think.
Can you still play it?
Oh, yeah. I sort of played it like this. And then I became infatuated by pianists like Winifred Atwell and people like that. She was my idol. And Charlie Coons and all those sort of people that used to make records like Let's Have Another Party, Volume 53.
Give us a bit of the Winifred Atwell style.
Oh, it was the sort of...
Elton was amazing his nearest and dearest with precocious impersonations of the piano. His future partner, Bernie Taupin, was growing up in the rich farmlands of Lincolnshire, in a little village with the improbable name of Normby by Spittle. His obvious love of the countryside is often reflected in his lyrics. There's slim times when my words won't rhyme, and the hills I face are a long, hard climb. Who'll walk me down to church when I'm 60 years of age, when the ragged dog they gave me has been 10 years in the grave? He still makes his home in Lincolnshire, in another small village some 7 miles from his birthplace. He and his American wife, Maxine, live snug as country mice in a Beatrix Potter doll's house they have named Piglet in the Wilds, his favourite reading being such childhood classics as The Wind in the Willows and Pooh of Pooh Corner. He is a gentle and unassuming person who has perfected the technique of remaining anonymous in a crowd, the Cartier-Bresson, as it were, of the pop world, who resents his lyrics being described as poetry, yet records everything with a poet's camera, anticipating with uncanny accuracy the shifting needs of his fickle audience. Success has singed but not burnt him. He writes as he feels, when he feels, self-isolated in a nostalgic ivory tower inhabited by yesterday's heroes and surrounded by the golden discs that signify that nostalgia has its rewards, producing superior lyrics that more often than not are eventually overwhelmed by the mandatory volume of electronic sound.
On the whole, I have to write possibly 24, 30 songs a year. Alton will phone up and say, the time is right, start writing. I usually just set aside 2 weeks and go upstairs in the office, you know, in the study, and sit down and work possibly 3 hours a day, 4 hours a day. Just work sort of solidly from there.
Tell the story of how you and Bernie got together, because that's rather interesting, isn't
it? It was through an advert in a paper. I was banging around the countryside. Well, I was playing around the countryside. And there was this advert saying, talent wanted. So I thought, hello, they've put an advert, and I shall answer it immediately. It was Liberty Records, in fact, when they went independent and they left EMI. They set up their own offices. And I answered it, and someone said, come in, come in. And I did, and they said, no. But they put me together with Bernie, because he'd written in as well. He said, I write lyrics. And I could write melodies, but I could never write lyrics. Well, I tried. I mean, they're really just painful.
I write the words, and he writes the melody, so there's no need for us to sit together and do it together. As I say, I'm sure it would be a disaster.
Need not see each other at all. In fact, we very rarely see each other anyway, except when we're on tour or we're recording. Yeah, this, I mean, he just comes down to London and hands me a batch of sort of lyrics. That's all it's done. It's very, very uncomplicated. That really is all there is to it. Usually I sort of potter around and find a chord sequence that I like, and then just, it doesn't take me very long. It takes me about, on average, about half an hour a song.
I've never tried to be a philosopher or get involved in songs that are anyway protest songs or political songs. I'm not that way inclined anyway.
I think we're the most prolific songwriters there are around today, really. I mean, singer-songwriters. I'm not talking about people who sit down and write songs as a business. Yeah. I don't write songs, don't regard writing songs as a business. I regard it as a sort of just an expression.
I don't usually sit down and say, I want to write a song about this subject or that subject. It's usually, I mean, take for instance, when I did Rocket Man, I was just driving along in the car and I came up with the first line, you know, about she packed my bags last night, pre-flight, 0 hours, 9 a.m, I'm going to be high as a kite by now. I just came, all of a sudden I was just driving along and that came up and I thought, oh yeah, that's nice. So when I got back, I immediately wrote that down and started following it up from then. I mean, I didn't really know at the time I thought of that it was going to be a song about an astronaut.
She packed my bags last night, flight, 0 hour, 9 a.m. And I'm gonna be high as a kite by then. I miss the earth so much, I miss my wife. It's lonely out in space on such a timeless flight. And I think it's gonna be a long, long time. The touchdown brings me round and get to mine. Not the man that think I am at home.
I always knew I'd be famous one day. I mean, I was always convinced. And I knew I'd probably have to wait till I was 53. But I just knew, you know, it's just the only thing that kept me going, really, was just this ambition. Well, it was an ambition, but I just knew that one day, sooner or later, I would have success in some field or other.
your eminence was very fast.
Well, it was fast as far as America goes, but it was a gradual process for me, because I was sort of professional since 17 and I didn't make it till I was about 23. So I had 6 years of taking my equipment up and down smoky clubs in England and Scotland and Wales, and I'm only 26. And I think that really my best work is, of course, to come. I don't think I've matured enough yet to have written anything great. I've written about two or three potentially standard great songs, which, you know, it's a bit boring to say standard, but I mean, songs that will get recorded for quite a long time.
Which do you think they are?
Your song, I suppose, and I think probably Daniel. Daniel, my brother, you are. I've just written 20 new songs and they're my favourites. I regard songs as sort of postage stamps. You lick them, put them on a letter and you never see them again. I mean, I can't remember the lyrics or some of the melody or the chords to the album I made 2 years ago, like Tumbleweed Connection. I can't remember hardly any of the songs. I mean, I'm more interested in the ones I've just written. I think songs are very disposable nowadays.
Hi, this is Elton, and you'll have 25 years of me squeezed into 1 week on VH1.
VH1's Elton Jonathan continues tomorrow night at 10. VH1 goes behind the scenes at the making of Elton's new album, Made in England. VH1's Elton Jonathan, tomorrow night at 10, only on VH1.
The most exclusive entertainment event of the year.
Eyeglasses at Envision, Envision.
Why do you think that a lot of people don't understand pop?
Some people don't even bother to listen, you know. But more and more people that are buying records by Andy Williams and Tony Bennett, if they're still buying those records, they'll find that most of the songs written on them are by pop writers of today, you know. And so, really, even though they don't like pop music, the records they're buying mostly are being written by young writers.
Don't they listen to the lyric at all?
In England, they sort of come to bop around and that. But in the States, they sit down and listen to it and get into... To everything that's happening on stage.
What do you think you give to your audience? What makes the phenomena of pop work?
Kids want to hear noise. They want to hear melody, but they want to hear something that's going to really get them up. I mean, it was like, I suppose, in the old days when traditional jazz was popular. I mean, it was a completely new thing and people danced to it. I can't see rock and roll ever dying now, because it's been dying for 15 years. I think kids really get a big buzz out of dancing to it. They just like to have their eardrums splattered.
Oh,
starting groups that go on 1 trillion noise, or they just keep going at a certain rate. I think it's very important to start up there, go down, start up, and then just keep letting them down. And then the final climax coming towards the end, it's sort of like having sex, really. You just try and keep the best bit until the end.
I want you to sing it really loudly. There's 80,000 of you. You'll make much noise and we can on stage. Come on now. Now to four. 1, 2, 3.
Bald, aging, and playing the piano in a pub somewhere.
Thank you. Thank you, Alan.
Hello, baby, hello. Haven't seen your face for a while. Have you quit doing time for me? Or are you still the same spoiled child?
Oh no, I disagree. I never was a superb classical pianist. My hands, look at that. They're not pianist hands, they're midget boxer's hands. Look at them. I just about barely stretch an octave when I was at the Academy. I had to read music, and that's all gone by the board, because if you don't keep it up, it just all goes. I mean, I try now, and I can read chord sheets just as easy as that, but the actual notes, I'm not particularly good at. I could, but I can't be bothered. I don't need to read music.
And what about your eating habits? I see you're having your normal breakfast.
Oh, yes. The Cod War is on, you know. We've been reduced to this sort of stainless steel pilchard. No, it's a bronze by Paul Wunderlich, a German artist.
Are you interested in food?
Of course. I mean, that's why I'm so fat. I've got this horrible ability to eat the wrong things, and I always put on so much weight. Like, I'm only going to eat a slice of Mother's Pride and I'm instantly the size of the Crystal Palace. So, yeah, food, I mean, I love food, any sort of food you like. The only thing I don't really like is sort of stews, because I used to live, I mean, my mother and my stepfather and I lived on stew for about 2 years once, and I never want to see another stew in my life. Horrible things, pearl barley floating around, and pearl Bailey floating around in it. So, no, I like all food, you know. I really like French food a lot, and my favourite's a curry. Indian food is my favourite food, but unfortunately you can only have three meals of that a week and you're sort of nowhere to be, no one will get near, you know, you're the gastronome's horror.
Let's talk about your clothes, because you're a great dresser.
Clothes are like music. There's certain sort of fads. I go through the 40s stage, or a t-shirt week, or a very smart suit 2 weeks. They make you feel good, clothes.
And glasses.
I'm a great believer in getting as many pairs of spectacles. There's nothing so boring if you're blind, like I am nearly, well, sort of, I can't see very well, to get up and put the same pair of glasses on each day. I mean, I'm driving around the bend, so I've got about 25 different pairs of glasses, and they make me feel different. Each pair makes me feel different, and they also coincide with the colour that I feel like today, you know. I'm very English today, red, white and blue, you see.
Do you design them yourself?
No, there's a shop in Hollywood. They usually have great frames, but if I want something, like I've just ordered a pair of ski goggles with lenses and to wear on stage, they'll do it. They just sort of laugh and go upstairs and sort of fall about laughing, but they're very good. They do anything I want. I'm having actually glasses made in the shape of a poodle. I mean, I'm very annoyed that I never won the Glasses Man of the Year award. I'm sure most people think because they're so ridiculous that they haven't got lenses in them, you see. And we sort of Michael Caine wears Glasses Man of the Year award. He's worn the same pair for 70 years. I've keeping the opticians of the world in money, I tell you. If you look at that, that sums up how I am. Crazy.
I think he's a paradox in himself to a great extent. He's an introvert that projects a tremendous extrovert performance and image. He's very sincere, and of course he can be very brash as well.
He's had darker moods since he sort of made it into the pop world than he ever did before. He's always been a very quiet boy, though. Never been a boy to sort of have the gay life or anything. He's always been very quiet, so that... I know, though, when he's in a mood, but I don't ever expect him to sort of be over the moon any time, because he's just not that nature.
The artist on his way up, the artist in the very depth of despair that he's never going to get anywhere, you know, that the darkest before the dawn, so to speak, the artist lives with failure magnificently. I've never yet met one that can live with success.
Oh, he's adapted very well. He has changed, obviously. One must change. But he's coped and adapted very well with all the things that success brings.
He has an expensive taste in champagne.
He has expensive taste in everything. I don't think that is acquired with the success. I think that was always there, because when I first knew him at the beginning, he always had expensive tastes.
Where did you first meet Elton?
I was working for EMI at the time, running the Tamla Motown label for the American Motown Company. He used to come in and out the office, ferret around looking for records. He's always collecting records. Well, when I really got to know him, he had just played Los Angeles, and he rang me, kind of lost English soul in San Francisco, and he told me about how the critics had received him in Los Angeles, and he was bubbling over, he was dying to tell someone about it. So I was the nearest thing to an Englishman. Had a good friendship after that, and then sometime later, about 6 months after that, he asked me to become his manager, and I did.
Elton John, in his stage performance, is bringing something back to show business that show business very badly needs. And this is genuine showmanship.
What do you feel when you walk out on stage?
I don't know. I don't really think about it. My mind's a complete blank. I don't feel anything. I don't feel anything at all. I can't think of a word that sums up how I feel when I walk down stage.
Why do you have to hear that, Carla?
There's not much of it, you see, and I shouldn't do these things to it, but I just get terribly bored with my hair. I just think, why can't you have yellow hair and green hair? It makes, you know, I'm a bit crazy like that. Yeah. It'll be a different colour next week, probably.
You made it a sort of feature now.
It's a reaction against everything that I wasn't allowed to do when I was a child, like a teenager. I wasn't allowed to wear winkle picker shoes because it might have hurt my feet. I wasn't allowed to wear hush puppies. Can you imagine anything so ridiculous when they became fashionable? I wasn't allowed to do anything. I was sort of kept well under wraps, and everything now I'm making up for lost time. I enjoy the freedom, and I just think, why not green hair? Why can't you have half a blue face and half a white face? I really like eccentricity.
Like being interviewed in the bath.
I think that the trouble with politicians today is that there's too much slandering.
You send yourself up, don't you, a great deal in your interviews?
Yes, I always felt that my public image was a bit too good, and good boy, and he's a lovely boy and all that. I always felt it was a bit goody-goody, sort of as similar to sort of Cliff Richard. I always thought I was the rock and roll new Cliff Richard, which I always fought against. But it's just the way I come across, unfortunately.
What are your vices?
The only thing I have vices are really sort of collecting things. I think that's a vice. It's just a... What do they call people that collect things?
Collectors.
Collectors. Good spotting.
Do you have a great deal of personal willpower? I mean, if you set your mind to do something, can you carry it out?
Oh, I've always had great personal willpower, yes. I mean, I'm terribly steely as far as... if I know I'm going to lose weight, or I want to lose weight, I can do it straight away in very short time without causing damage to my body system. You know, I've been sort of on my last legs, but I've still performed. I'm sort of very conscious about not letting anybody down. I've got great responsibility built into me about letting people down. You know.
Who do you admire most?
I admire the Beatles for what they've been through. I think they got conned and ripped off like nobody else should have done in their position, because they're such immensely talented people. And I admire the Rolling Stones because they've been through hell and fire water as well, and they're still together. I think those two people, the two groups that I admire most. I travelled all the way up to Batley Variety Club to see Dusty Springfield because she was my childhood sweetheart, and I had 70 million pictures of her from Ravalli stuck on my bedroom wall, you know, which when the wall went down, all went like that. Very heartbreaking.
Where was that?
When I used to live in Northwood Hills in Middlesex. And I mean, Groucho, I love legends, you know, Groucho Marx, Noel Coward, Laurel and Hardy, people like that. I just... infatuated by them. I think they're amazing. Mae West. I met Mae West, and she's fantastic. You know, I went to see Marlene Dietrich, for example, in London, and she left me so spellbound, not because she sang great, but she was just there, and she gave off a great presence from the stage. I mean, she gave me a dishwasher, for example. No, I'm say that again. No, I was so mesmerised by her. I came out of the theatre and someone said, "Hey, Elton, will you give us your autograph?" And I signed it, "Yes, best wishes, Marlene Dietrich." And I felt a complete idiot. This girl looked at me and said, "Oh, you put Marlene Dietrich?" And I was so embarrassed, you know. But that's the sort of people that I really admire.
And you were singing at the time. Where are the boys?
Falling in love again. I swept out there in a dress and I said, "Falling in love again." And I was Marlene Dietrich for 5 minutes. At the moment, I've got a great... hate of the business side of things. The thing I hate about, well, I suppose it applies to anything in entertainment, is that people who know nothing about what they're doing, films, music, books, or whatever it may be, earn the greatest amount of money, and usually the author or the composer or whoever created it usually ends up with bugger all, really. It's that really makes me really fume. I can't stand the leeches in this business. You're just a product. You could be a washing powder. You sell X records and they love you. You don't sell another record perhaps for another 6 months and they don't particularly like you. They don't know what it's like to go on the road and take your own equipment around. They have no feeling for an artist at all.
One thing I noticed about you, that you don't sort of talk the jargon very much.
Oh, I can't stand all that. I hate, there is a jargon in pop music and it goes sort of similar like, oh man, I really
dig your record. I'm saying I really got Space the other night and Stone Man, and I, it was what a trip, man. And then I went round to the supermarket, and what a bummer, man. All those straights there, really, getting themselves together, trying to hustle some bread together for the weekend. That's, you know, that's the job. I can't stand that. I mean, I really think it's, you know, spaced out, man. I really feel spaced out. Yeah. We've got our own language in the band anyway, I suppose. It's called bad language.
Elton has composed and recorded most of his albums in France, in a partially derelict chateau in the small village of Héroville, some 50 kilometres outside Paris. And it's indeed odd to find tomorrow's music being made in yesterday's crumbling splendour. Here, in very Spartan conditions, he and the group lead a strange monastic existence for the best part of a month, working by night and sleeping by day. Within these historic walls, a far cry from Timpan Alley, Top of the Pops, and the multi-million dollar razzmatazz of the record industry, tomorrow's hits are being forged in splendid isolation. There is a scent of fresh-mown grass outside, but not a suspicion of it inside. For Elton John lives deliberately apart from the mainstream of current pop philosophy. And this withdrawal is deliberate and considered. Inside the chateau at the moment, there is a lot of talent and many thousand pounds worth of very sophisticated electronic equipment.
Attention all video void.
Here now. Well, four, because this is like a double album. It's got such good atmosphere here, and it's great to work here, you know, it's so easy and laid back. He'll get up early or whatever, and he has words. If Bernie's not here, he'll have lyrics. And he'll sit down at the piano and play about, and within half an hour, he's written a song, you know. There's never a note written down. He keeps it in his head.
When we did Tonka Chateau, Bernie was here writing the lyrics, bringing them downstairs. Elton was sitting at the piano writing them, and then half an hour later we'd sit down and learn them, the band, you know. And that's the way it goes.
Literally as quickly as that?
Oh, yeah. It's amazing. It was just like a factory. The nooks were coming down, Elton was sitting down and writing the song. And we'd be sitting having breakfast and we'd just join in. And within about an hour and a half, we've got the basis of the song.
And at that stage, you're busking it?
Oh, sure, yeah, we just learn the song.
To say to somebody, I know somebody who writes great songs and he can write 10 in half an hour, you'd think, come on, you know, they can't be that great. But he does that.
I think he has enough talent and drive and energy to achieve whichever measure of success he wants. He has a Jekyll and Hyde character, and that leads to the fact that you never know what he's going to do next. He's totally unpredictable.
It was totally unpredictable for an ex-Lincolnshire farmhand to sit down and write a poignant lyric about a girl who died 11 years ago with 4.5 milligrams of Nembutal in her bloodstream. Totally unpredictable that the precocious impersonator from Pinner should then put those words to music in a matter of hours. The shotgun wedding collaboration between Elton and Burney once again anticipating a cult from afar. For they were ahead of Norman Mailer in recognizing that Marilyn Monroe continues to exert an attraction that goes beyond nostalgia.
I read quite a lot about her and started to collect things on her, books on her and old posters and things like that. And the more I read about her, the more insight I got to her. I'm not saying that I have a lot of knowledge about Marilyn Monroe, but she just fascinates me. I think There was a lot about Marilyn Monroe that people didn't understand. I think she was very ill-treated by the system that she was involved in. And that's what really made me want to write a song, trying to put across my feelings on the whole subject, saying that she was very misused by the industry.
The thing that comes out about Marilyn Monroe most is the pain. You know, she was... To me, I think of Marilyn Monroe and I think of pain and sort of complete torment. That's the sort of thing I think about when anyone mentions her name. I can't ever imagine Marilyn Monroe being that happy.
I had the idea of Candle in the Wind because that's how I pictured her life, you know, as a candle in the wind, you know, which, I mean, the phrase has been used before, but it's a nice phrase. And I thought that was such a nice way to put her life into a lyric. That pushed me on to sort of write the rest of the song. She was a people's actress. She wasn't just a sex symbol, she was somebody that they could possibly talk to.
She just came across as, to me, as being someone who just pathetically needed help.
Possibly because I think the melody is so strong and that there was a lot of feeling put into the lyrics. And I really feel for the song.
Bye-bye, shadow, I must leave you. Oh, it breaks my heart to go. No, it doesn't.
Elton John, an improbable talent who happens to be real. Aided and abetted by his lyricist Bernie Taupin, who puts into words their view of life and perhaps their future epitaph. Sometimes you dream, sometimes it seems there's nothing there at all. You just seem older than yesterday, and you're waiting for tomorrow to call.
Another year, another album, Bye Bye Français, arrivederci, and his brother Sim.
Bye bye, Shadow.
Goodbye, no, never seen again.